This is a fantastic crowd. I know you're not there to see me, so we're going to get through the general meeting fairly quickly and then get to Barbara's presentation. Welcome all to the general meeting for the South Florida Historical Society. The only thing I want to announce before we get to the main business session is that next, our February meeting, we will not be here. We're going to go to the Pioneer Day at Merritt Island Sam's House. We're going to have a booth there, a table. So please don't come here, but I encourage you to attend the Pioneer Day up at Sam's House. You can look online, look at our website or Sam's House, and you'll see the information. Or you can call me. My number is on the website. So I declare the 2017 annual business meeting of SPHS now in session. Just for the brief annual report, it was our 50th anniversary last year. We had really good presentations. Our traveling trunk made its debut at a local homeschool group of like 20 students from kindergarten through 12th grade. They all enjoyed it, really had a great time with it. Spent about an hour and a half talking about agricultural history as it related to Brevard, so that was really positive. And then we ended up in our June meeting with Bob Gross having a table, a forum with three local, Diane Milligan, Ernest Cohenhoven, and then Bob Barwell, and then Leon Tucker. We had a dialogue about growing up in Brevard, and that was really good. And we're going to do something very similar in our June meeting. So just keep an eye out on our different programs. This time, I'd like the 2016 Board of Directors to stand up and be recognized. They did an awesome job for everyone this year. Okay, so as you all came in, you got the report, your sheet here. On the back of it is the treasurer's report. And then on the front, you have a budget, and then the nominees for this year. So what I'd like to do is adopt the 2017 budget. Is there any questions before we go on?
Yes. Could you clarify, it talks about the reserves, and are the reserves those three accounts with Chase?
It's only the first account. The other two are dedicated because of grants, and the Kellersberger Fund was specific to just promoting or publishing books. So we don't touch those two. The reserves come out of the general, that top account with the $9,000 in it.
Yeah. And this is my first year. Have you been drawing from that for prior years?
Is
it about to run out?
No. Yeah, we talked about that. We're not going insolvent or anything. So what it does is waxes and wanes, because we'll have a home tour. It puts a lot of money into the account, and then we spend a year or two without a home tour, and then we draw from it. Like next year, we're going to have a home tour. That'll put a significant amount of money back into the account. And the other thing is, the budgets are proposed. We don't spend everything that's on here. So that's something we could clarify next year, is that just because we say we're going to spend every dollar, we don't. And we don't spend more. We usually either people donate services or we get discounts, so we always... or underrunning the budget itself.
Yeah. Speaking of donation, I see that there's a listing of donation in kind, or it says in kind.
That's correct.
I'm not quite familiar with a cash accounting system where you get a non-cash item in unless you're planning on renting it out or converting it.
Pretty much what it is we have a donation in kind of our storage unit. We pay half, and then the AAA storage pays the other half. That's a donation in kind. Mm-hmm. So it's like matching funds, mm-hmm. things like. But you have to account for it.
I guess it's not, whatever.
We can talk that afterwards.
Sure.
And I'm not the accountant. I just play one up here for 15 minutes and then I get back to my regular job. But I can talk to you afterwards with any other questions. So if there is any other questions, I'd like to someone from the floor to make a motion to approve the 2017 budget.
So moved.
Okay, thanks.
Second.
And then second?
Second.
Okay, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any nays? All right. All right, and then, thank you. And then for the election of, now we're going to the election of the officers and directors. I first want to thank Barbara Arthur, Beth Glover, and then Jennifer Marks for putting the committee together and working hard. If you'll stand up and we can all thank them. Sorry, I'm standing, you guys got it. Thank you all for your great work in that. So I'd like to open up the meeting to from nominations from the floor. Does any other nominations? Okay, so I declare the nominations closed. And hearing no nominations or objections from the floor, I declare the slate of nominees elected by acclamation. Okay. Moving right along. Okay. So the last thing I'd like to do is, Ed Wasaka has been a board member. He was president of our society for quite some time. He worked at the museum, and he's done a whole lot within, during the years as a director, setting up exhibits on the library and other places. He wrote a book about the wood, logging industry, thank you. And so we'd like to recognize him for all his service. He's retired from the board, he did that in October. We'd like to recognize him for his service and make him an honorary life member. The board has agreed with that, but we need you all's a motion to do that, and then a second, and then vote. So Robert, it's first, kind of a second for that? Okay, very good, thank you. And then all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All right, so moved. We're doing great. All right. So are there any other items that anyone wishes to bring up at this time? This is our general meeting. You can always talk in any meeting, but this is the formality. Yes.
Again, the March meeting.
Yes, okay, I was getting to that. So, all right, so as you came in, I don't know if you saw, but in our March meeting, we won't be here. We're going to be at the Melbourne Auditorium just down the road for
Melbourne High School
Auditorium, thank you. And that we're going to have Rick Smith talk about his father, Patrick Smith, and the book, A Land Remembered. We're selling tickets up there. Members, it's $5. Non-members, it's $10. Seating is limited to 225, so I encourage you to buy your tickets pretty quick. We're going to start putting flyers out in the community in early, mid-February, so you guys have first dibs on and getting seats and everything. It's going to be a great event. Rick Smith does a very visual, interactive presentation on his father and then how the book got developed and all the other things that his father had done. So I encourage you to check out the website and also go. I think it'll be a really good show. Now for the best part of the program, Barbara Arthur. She's going to talk about Honest John's Fish Camp, the South Beaches, and Oak Lodge. So please, everyone, give a round of applause for Barbara.
Everyone for coming. The more people that have come in the door, the more nervous I've gotten. I'm sure I'll make it through. My family's lived in Brevard County since the 1880s, and I grew up in South Brevard in a place called Honest John's Fish Camp. And so I'm going to talk about some of the memories I have as growing up, and also about Oak Lodge, and tell you a little bit about the things I remembered on the South Beaches as I grew up. So, now if I can get this to work like John told me to. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to set the stage by giving you an article, a talk, or actually it was an article that Rena Hoop did for the book, Melbourne Beach, the First 100 Years, and it's going to take you on a journey from Melbourne Beach to Sebastian Inlet. And it was a lot different in those days than it is now, and so that's what you'll see first. The road to Sebastian Inlet was desperate. You would start in the morning when the dew of the night was still on the ground. You would carry a shovel, a hatchet, and some gunny sacks, or at least old pieces of carpeting, and you'd start out. It was one way through deep sand ruts, and you would pray that you didn't meet another car, because one of you would have to pull over and you might have to use that shovel and hatchet to cut palmettos and the sacks to give additional traction for the spinning wheels. The paved road ended at Melbourne Beach at 3rd Avenue. And after that, what an adventure. The rattlesnakes were thick all the way down there through that brush. And once there, you wouldn't think of going back until late afternoon. You would pray that in the meantime, there had also been a light rain to pack the sand down. You were less likely to meet another car in the late afternoon, plus the fact that it was cooler. I don't think there were three houses along those 17 miles down there, and I'm not sure they were always occupied. But the fishing down at the inlet was excellent. Sebastian Inlet has been called dangerous and treacherous by a lot of people, and that's the way to describe it. This was the 30s and 40s quote that Rena used. And Rena was a resident of Melbourne Beach. I didn't know her personally, but I remember her daughter, Roxy, lived there, I think it was on like 6th Avenue. And she rode my mother's school bus, so that's how I knew Roxy. As a child, I remember going to the inlet in our beach buggy, which had wide tires for better traction in the sand, and it was an adventure. At some point in the 40s, the beach road was paved as far south as the northern driveway to the Coast Guard station. From there to the inlet, it was deep, rutted, one-lane road. The Coast Guard station is also now called SBI, the Sebastian E. Chin, so that will give you a place that you can know if you go down that way. If you did meet a car coming towards you, which was not a normal occurrence, you tried to time the passing where there was a break in the palmettos alongside the road. And hanging on, you crossed the center hump of the road and put your left tires in the right lane and the right tires in the clearing. And then the oncoming vehicle would do the same, and quickly you would pass and get your tires back into the left-hand rut. So that it was an adventure. As a child, I always thought we were going to get stuck. This is only one of the memories I had as a child growing up on the property that is now known as Honest John's Fish Camp. When my grandfather homesteaded this property in 1887, there was no A1A. He and his brother Charlie sailed into Mullet Creek to take shelter from the storm that was brewing. They had been looking up and down the Indian River for land to homestead. The next morning, after the storm had passed, they got out on the land and found that it was good land for farming because they were both farmers. So they went to Titusville, which was the county seat, and found that the property was unsurveyed government property land. They returned to Mullet Creek and they built a cabbage palm shack using the trunks of the palms as the uprights and the palm fronds for the thatched roof. The floor was dirt, and it took 15 years for them to prove up on the land. And President Teddy Roosevelt signed the deed March 17, 1903. I have a picture, that you can come up later and look at. But what it shows is the sailboat that they sailed in, and it was a shallow draft sailboat. This was the first building that they built. I don't think my grandmother lived there but about a year, and then they built the house that's now standing. This picture was taken because they had to prove that they had cleared the land, they had built a permanent structure, and they had planted crops. And so that's probably the only reason that we even have the picture. You can come up later, and my grandfather is on the left and my great uncle's on the right.
This
is the collards in the foreground, and in the wheelbarrow are sweet potatoes, and they call them yams.
How many acres did they homestead?
158 point something or other. Usually 160 acres is about what they would homestead. On that particular government homestead grant. I think I went too far. Hold on a minute. This is a copy. We have the original copy, but this is a copy of the grant that my grandfather received. And it's 150, let's see. 158 and 79 hundredths of an acre. To be specific. And this is the picture I just showed you. This is the grindstone. That was a very important instrument back then because they needed that to keep their hoes and shovels very sharp because they were farmers and were digging in the earth. And so they used that. We still have the remnants of that grindstone. And there was a dog that he just sort of out of the picture right there. That was Uncle Charlie, and that was my grandfather. Robert Toombs Smith. That's a strange name, I know, but his father fought in the Civil War under General Toombs in Georgia, and so he thought so much of his commanding officer that he named his son's middle name as Toombs. So I always thought that was really weird to have a name like Toombs. let's see. I think you can see that they are wearing long sleeves because of the mosquitoes were really, really bad. And so you had long pants, you wore socks, and covered as much skin as you possibly could in order to keep the mosquitoes from biting on you. I remember going out into the yard and when I was young, and we would build a fire. And we'd take moss from the trees and we'd put it on the fire to create smoke. And so that would, you would get in the smoke from the fire and that would, the mosquitoes wouldn't get in there, so you would be protected from the mosquitoes. There were also sandflies, lots of sandflies, and I remember waking up in the morning and they'd be in your hair and your scalp would itch, and I hated the sandflies, I think, more than I hated the mosquitoes. When my father, Honest John, was young, he would say that in the morning they would take the shotgun and aim it to the east and fire it off to see if the sun was up because of the huge swarms of mosquitoes. And as a child, I always believed that too. Shelby Strother was a writer for Florida Today, and he wrote a book called Saddlebags. And in the book, he quoted my brother as saying, "Dad got to where mosquitoes didn't bother him. I used to walk up behind him and he wouldn't have a shirt on and his back would be almost black with mosquitoes. I'd slap at them and there would be this big smear of blood all over his back. I'd ask him, didn't you feel them? And he'd just shake his head." He never had air conditioning and there were screens on the windows to keep the mosquitoes out. He would have a fan which would circulate, but he didn't believe in the air conditioning, and he didn't believe in TV. He never had a TV either. So, and he was born in the house there. My maternal, actually great, I should have great grandfather was John Baker Wells, and he came from Missouri, and when he came, he brought his sons. Walter, let's see here if I can get the right ones. This is Walter Wells, John Baker Wells, Lon Wells, my grandmother Elizabeth Wells, and her sister Rosa Wells. Now remember Lon upper left because I'll talk about him a little bit later. When my paternal grandfather came to Florida, he came from southwest Georgia after the Civil War to drive a wagon team for a retired doctor. And since there were no marked roads, they had to figure out which way to come. And so on the way, they stopped at Hawthorne, which is up in north central Florida. And that first year, they made a crop there. And but the doctor that he was driving the team for wanted to come on down to the Indian River, where he had heard that the breeze of the trade winds was so strong that it would blow the soup right out of your bowl. Somebody was a good marketer. Upon arriving in Titusville, which was then called Sandpoint, Granddaddy had 25 cents in his pocket and he bought a steamboat ticket to Melbourne. He found a cot in the attic of Campbell's store near Front Street. Part of the first year he was there, he worked in a store before he took a contract for rafting lumber from the steamboat, which carried the lumber to build the Carlton Hotel there in Melbourne. After that, he got a job working in the pineapple fields that were on the high ground close to the beach, south of Melbourne Beach. The workers came across the river in a boat, and they had a horse and wagon to carry them down to the pineapple fields to work. But the big freeze of 1894 and 95 wiped out the pineapple crop. It was tough to make a living during that period of time. So one of the things they would do would be to go and pick palmetto berries, and they would then ship them up to a pharmaceutical company up north. And the company made tonic out of the palmetto berries. And they bought about 20 cents a pound, and sometimes even got a little bit more than that. They picked these berries, they dried them, and they shipped them to the company called Park Davis. You probably have heard of that.
I think tonic,
you know, just any kind of tonic just cured anything. You know, so I think it was maybe a cure-all tonic. Whatever malady you had, I think it cured it, you know.
For prostate cancer treatment.
Thank you.
There are people picking them here.
Okay, Jennifer said they use them in Europe for prostate cure. Soft palmetto. Yes.
That's what they use them for.
Yeah. When my grandfather got married, he bought out his brother's share of the land, and he built a bigger house. And this house is a two-story cracker-style house, a cracker eye house. The first five children were born on the homestead, and the last three were born in Grant across the river. So this census of 1910 shows my grandfather, my grandmother, Laura, who's John Hyatt's mother, Charner, and my father, and his sister, Ida, and his brother, Bill. Granddaddy set Grandma up in a store in Grant when the three oldest Smith children were school age. There were three children on the mainland, which made six, and that was enough to have a school. They went to school in the summertime because Granddaddy needed his sons to work on the truck farm in the wintertime. So they only went to school like 3 months out of the year. This shows the entire Smith family. My father is there. Charner was the oldest, and Elmer was the youngest male, and Viola was the youngest female.
Where are you?
Where am I? I'm not in this picture. This is my father and his family. But people do say that it looked like my aunt down there in the bottom left. She was a captain in the WAX, and when they see pictures of her when she was older, they say I looked like her. When Granddaddy and Uncle Charlie started their truck farm, the grubbing was hard and it was done by hand. They dug up the land a little at a time and planted vegetables. Granddaddy's business card read, R.T. Smith Farming. in beans I trust. It's true, I've seen his little business card. He made the most money from his string beans, but he also planted tomatoes and bell peppers. Later, he planted citrus trees, because when the big freeze came, the oranges on the peninsula didn't freeze. Granddaddy decided if it was mild enough to survive the freeze, he would set out a grove of citrus. And you probably noticed that I do not call this Barrier Island, I call this peninsula. Our family always called it the peninsula. You were on the mainland or you were on the peninsula. Mr. A.B. Michael of Wabasso asked my grandfather to set out a citrus grove. Granddaddy asked Mr. Michael which part of his bean field he wanted him to set out first. He said to set out the deer field since the deer were eating up the beans. Thereafter, the grove was called Deerfield Groves, and it remained with that name for many years until the state purchased the land, and this is land adjacent to us on the east, and it's now called the Indian River Lagoon Preserve State Park. So it's been taken out of the private. Pardon me?
I was just wondering, where is the Indian River Lagoon Preserve?
Do you know where Floridana Beach is?
Yes.
It's adjacent to that on the west and on the south.
Oh.
Yeah. And they have moved the road in entrance into our place north to go around the community center. There's a community center there. And the road from the A1A is paved to the end where it goes into the old Mullet Creek Road coming into our place, and that's still dirt. The Cracker Eye House was built in 1899 and has two main rooms downstairs and two same-size rooms upstairs divided by a stairway. The kitchen was separate structure attached by a breezeway. This is the kitchen portion here. Houses were built this way because in the summertime you had the heat that you had to contend with, and if you by chance had a fire in the kitchen, it did not consume the entire living quarters. When my great uncle moved to Merritt Island after Granddaddy bought out his share, he had a portion which is, you can't see it in this picture, but it was about that area right there, and because his truck farm was too close to the ocean and the salt air, he could not grow his vegetables up there. He then barged his little shack down the river to the homestead, and they attached it to the back of the kitchen. So the boards don't, if you're there, the boards don't match up. So that's, and when I was a child, that's where my grandfather lived, and so we call that Granddaddy's kitchen. Yes.
And this is the house that's still standing.
The house built in 1899 is still standing, yes. This one right here. I have one son who lives in the two-story house, and I have one son that lives in the one-story house. This structure here used to be a barn, and Buckskin was the name of the horse. And they had Buckskin because Granddaddy had a sugarcane mill, and they tied the long pole of the sugarcane mill to the horse's back, and he would go around the mill, and in doing so, he would then grind the sugarcane, which would have the juice come out and be collected in a large tub underneath, and then they would boil it down and make molasses. And you lived off the land. You made all of your own things, your garden, your fish, or whatever it was. You had to, you didn't have the grocery store or the convenience. Well, you didn't have A1A, so. And that's sort of another story. I'm just sort of getting off of my story here, but when my uncle Bill was ready to be born, Granddaddy got in his sailboat to go get the doctor to bring him over, because all the children were born in the house. There was no hospital. And unfortunately, on the way, the wind died down on the sailboat. And so the doctor didn't make it in time. So John's mother, who was the oldest of the family, and my grandmother were the ones that gave birth to my Uncle Bill. It was tough, especially being a woman, it was tough. There was a cistern under the house, and this was used as a reservoir for rainwater off the roof, as the only water they knew that was good water. The cistern held 50 barrels, and it was made of concrete. It was partially buried underground and came up from under the porch. The top was shaped into a cone with a small opening covered by cheesecloth. The exterior of the house was lapboard siding, and the wood was hard pine. A porch wrapped around three sides of the house, and the original roof was shaped shingles. A galvanized aluminum roof replaced the shingles in the 40s. We then replaced the galvanized shingles in 1999, and in doing so, we're advised to remove the shaped shingles for a couple of reasons. One was that there was they were good fire fodder, and the other was when they put the galvalume on the roof, it needed to lay flat, and with the shingles there, it didn't really lay flat, so we ended up removing all the shaped shingles, but the galvanized aluminum roof is on there today. I was raised in this house with my brother, and when he was old enough to go to school, there were five other children south of Melbourne Beach who also needed to be transported to town, which is Melbourne Beach, to meet the school bus. I guess six is a magic number here, six of grand. Anyway, there were three stone children, Orin, Janice, and Susan, and they lived near present-day Melbourne Shores. They were a really poor family, and they lived down on the river. Betsy Davies lived at Spanish Bayonet Motel, which is now called Ocean Pines Motel, and David Lindsay lived at Surfside Villas, where Driftwood Plaza is now located. This is a picture of the Surfside Villas. My mother was hired to transport these children to the town the year before I went to school. And then the next year, my mother was given a real bus and the route on the beach. She transported children from grades 1 through 12 from Sebastian Inlet to Canova Beach on one bus. See how much has grown? There weren't any schools on the barrier island, and so they were taken across the river to what is now known as the Henniger Center, or the Henniger Complex. They had three buildings there. The westernmost was the primary. They had first three grades there. And then the middle section, which is still there, was the fourth, fifth, and sixth. And then the high school, which has now been torn down, was for the junior high and high school.
So about what year are you talking about?
For what?
When she was doing the bus route.
1949 is when she took the my brother and five other children to Melbourne Beach. And then Ben Smith was the bus driver. I don't know if you, I've met Ben's granddaughter. She works here at Northrop Grumman. Ben was an insurance agent, and he had his office on New Haven Avenue. And so she would meet Ben and drop off the children, and then at night she would transport them back home. So that's not that long ago, or maybe it was. During World War II, there were four watchtowers south of Melbourne Beach. The last tower to survive was at the Coast Guard Station, or Sebastian Beach Inn. When I was a child, we'd go over, and you could, the stairways to go up, you could still go up, and then we'd go up there and look out over the ocean. But even, I think it was the hurricanes in 04, Jim, was it 04 hurricanes that they, 04 hurricanes that demolished the last one. My father was in the Coast Guard Auxiliary, and he stood watch over at the watchtower. They were looking for German U-boats, and these are pictures of his credentials being in the Coast Guard Auxiliary. He was too old to actually be drafted, and so he joined the Coast Guard Auxiliary. The Coast Guard station was built in the early part of the World War II, so it'd be like early 40s, but it's still there today. There were few cars traversing A1A in those days, and most of them were fishing going down to the inlet. There was little need to travel down this way as the road stopped at the inlet. Today, it's hard to get out onto A1A to drive to town. Alongside the road grew gallardias, black-eyed Susans, and periwinkles. The soil was sandy in most places, so you didn't want to drive off the road or you'd get stuck, and there wouldn't be anybody close by to help you get back on the road. So you were very careful that you stayed on the paved portion. There were also few houses south of Melbourne Beach. Aside from the hotels and motels mentioned earlier, there was Seagrave Manor, which is the top one, and that's no longer there, that's been demolished. And there was a Crystal Beach Motel, and that's also known as Seagrave Motel or Loggerhead, and that's also been destroyed, and homes have been built there. These postcards showing, I knew it as Crystal Beach Motel, and then they changed the name a couple of times. They had a swimming pool there, which was back in those days a luxury. They have a swimming pool.
It was Olympic size too.
It was big. Jim worked there, so he knows. Senator Richards had a small house located just south of where the Barrier Island Center is today. And Leonard Ryan had a house near, just north of the area that's known as Sunnyland. And Leonard made cigars there. And Homer Rodehaver bought a large piece of land, about 42 lots. He wanted to put in a Christian colony, and he called it Sebastian Pines. Mr. Rodehaver was an evangelist, and he was very had played instruments, and he knew my grandfather. I guess everybody knew Uncle Bob. And this is a note that he wrote to him. It says, to Uncle Bob Smith, with best wishes that you will be better soon. Homer Rodehaver. Dr. Eugene and Julia Lake Kellersberger bought property at Sebastian Pines from Mr. Rodehaver, and they were missionaries in Africa. Mrs. Kellersberger was called Mama Cuckoo because the African children couldn't pronounce her name, and so the best that they could do was call her Mama Cuckoo. She was a delightful lady, if any of you all knew her. She always had a smile on her face. And one day I had Dad in the car, and I'd taken him to town, and we stopped at the bank. And I went inside, and Mama Cuckoo was in there. And she said, "How's your father?" Because she really always liked Dad. And I said, "Oh, he's out in the car." She said, "Oh!" So she rushes out the door, and Dad's sitting there in the car with his arm out the window, you know. And so she looks in and says, "Oh, John, how are you?" And just grabs both of his cheeks and gives him a big smacker right on the lips. But she was, that was the type of person she was. She was really a grand lady. She wrote several books, and one of them is Rooted in Florida Soil, which the Kellersberger Fund of the Brevard Historical, South Brevard Historical Society published. And in that she writes, "Our local showplace is the ancestral home of Honest John, so named because the fantastic stories he tells could not possibly be true." His father, and she gets a little bit off on some of the dates and information, but you know, she does pretty good. His father migrated from Georgia in 1887 to work in the pineapple fields of Florida, which at that time constituted one of the state's main economic resources. Get my sheet here. He homesteaded 160 acres of land along the Indian River front, so impenetrable, his only access was by boat. In this rich primeval soil, he planted a truck garden, and in order to market his produce, he built a country store directly across on the mainland. That would be Grant. Above this primitive structure, his wife and children lived during the 3 months of the school year. Under these conditions, it is admirable that John finished the eighth grade. John's uncle carried the bale in a sailboat, the Southern Star, from Titusville or Sandpoint to Fort Pierce. Actually, it was more like Jupiter. And there it was handed to a postman who walked the beach to Miami and was called the Barefoot Mailman. There is a book on the Barefoot Mailman that is interesting reading. She goes on, having a descendant of such historical character living near us makes a visit to him with our guests quite frequent. They are fascinated by signs posted along the shaded entrance leading to his waterfront. Good people enter my property. Crooks, thieves, and pilfers keep out. Stopping on this road is trespassing. Honest John knows that those who stop will be tempted to steal his fruit. If you're looking around, just turn around. Pier under construction since 1888. Use it at your own risk. Pay here. An open jar on the steps in which to place the money for fishing privileges. He didn't pay. Bloody mark on the signpost. You know, when you live in such primeval areas, you know, you have to have some fun, right? Oak Lodge was a boarding house for naturalist scientists and ornithologists, and was located on Mullet Creek, where Ocarina is located today. Charles and Frances Eleanor Betts Latham were the proprietors. In a letter to my grandmother, dated March 8, 1949, Annie B. Morgan Locke, who was the granddaughter of Charles Latham, writes, Mr. and Mrs. Charles F. Latham came south May 2, 1882, and for a while lived at Rockledge, Florida, where Mr. Latham helped in the construction of the first Indian River Hotel at Rockledge. Both Mr. and Mrs. Latham had previously been married. So Mrs. Latham had her three daughters, Clara Fanning and Eva C. Betts, by her first marriage. These daughters she brought with her. Mr. L. brought his son Frank and daughter Grace Latham by his former marriage. And Grace is the lady that wrote this letter. They lived in the vicinity of Rockledge until 1885, when they moved over onto the peninsula. She refers to it as peninsula also, opposite Grant, Florida on Mullet Creek, where they homesteaded, living in a palmetto house until their first home, Oak Lodge, was completed. The spot homesteaded was a beautiful spot, noted for its scenic beauty, also for the abundance of game, ducks, bears, plenty of fishing, and oysters from the mangroves. Many noted scientists spent their winters there. The oysters that grow on the mangroves are called coon oysters. And the reason they call those is because the raccoons would go down to the water and they break those off and they eat the oysters. So they dub those coon oysters. Among those visitors to Oak Lodge were Charles Livingston Bull, wildlife illustrator, Frank M. Chapman, ornithologist at the American Museum of Natural History, William T. Hornaday, zoologist and taxidermist, Professor John Whipple Potter Jenks, director of the Museum of Natural History at Brown University, John Burroughs, naturalist and essayist, Newton Dexter, student at Brown University, Outram Bangs, curator of mammals at the Harvey Museum of Comparative Zoology, Charles Knight, artist at the American Museum of Natural History, William Beebe, naturalist and ornithologist, Louis Agassiz Huertes, ornithologist and artist, and Albert Thayer, naturalist and artist, and his son Gerald. So you could see there were really noted individuals that came to this wilderness to see the different flora and fauna that actually inhabited the area. Oak Lodge was a three-story structure with the third floor used for taxidermy. It burned down twice, once in September of 1893, and after it was rebuilt, it burned again on May 18, 1910. Some say it was set on fire for the insurance money. You will see right down there, there's a turtle skull. This little girl right here is Mr. and Mrs. Latham's daughter, and her name is Queenie. On August 8, 1899, Queenie Latham married Leonidas Lawn Hamilton Wells, who was my great uncle. So that's what my connection is to Oak Lodge. They had five girls, Millie, Alice, Blair, Sarah, and Gertrude. Queenie died shortly after Gertrude was born, so that left my great uncle with five little girls. This is the 1900 census it was enumerated by Charles W. Bolton. Charles Bolton married my grandmother's sister, Rosa Wells. He is also the individual that took the mail from Sandpoint down to meet the barefoot mailman. Ma Latham also had her mother, Clarissa E.W. Birch, living at the lodge. It was said she didn't want to be buried in this wilderness, although rumors have it that she was. Although a headstone sits in the Georgiana Cemetery on Merritt Island, according to my father and my Aunt Laura, her body was never taken there. She just put a tombstone there. Frank Chapman, in his book, Autobiography of a Bird Lover, describes the site, Oak Lodge, Mrs. Latham's home, was situated on the riverside of the East Peninsula. From it, a broad trail led through the forest and the palmetto to the sea. The north and south lay marshy savannas. On the Indian Riverside, near shore, there were several small mangrove-covered islands, the Mullet Creek Islands, partly enclosing an arm of the river on which our landing was situated. The fauna was primeval. Puma, wildcats, and deer were not uncommon. And when in May, loggerhead turtles came ashore to lay their eggs, black bears were there to unearth and eat them. This picture was taken in 1950s, and this is when the mosquito control came and started up in the north part, and they dredged down through here like this. And that's why it looks so white, because it's just the sand from the dredging. And now the trees have grown up and it doesn't look like that. Unfortunately, we have some Brazilian pepper and other non-native species too. This area here is called Latham Island, and Ocarina is in this area here. This is called Mullet Creek out there. In March 6, 1997, an historical marker was dedicated for Oak Lodge at the original site now located off Arena. And Laura Smith, eldest of the Smith children, and Gertrude Wells Fulton were in attendance. Gertrude was the youngest daughter of Lon Wells. This was the first meeting of the two cousins, and this picture shows Aunt Laura and Gertrude who sat together for that a ceremony. Professor J.W.P. Jenks, in a letter dated 28th of January, 1892, wrote, "Here I am isolated from all society except four or five fellow boarders. Here too I revel in the paradise of a naturalist, catching bear or panther in my bear traps, and wildcat, otter, coon, or possum in my smaller traps, and fish for shark, sawfish, bass, mullet, trout, etc. in my nets or by hook and line, and shooting ducks in great variety, and all the long-legged variety of birds, to say nothing of woodbirds, and all this variety without going off the 160 acres or out of gunshot hearing of the house. The fact is, this locality is primitive forest, broken into by settlers 7 years ago, but it is being settled up all too fast for me." That's really all I have to say, except that my family has always been noted for giving doing poems, and so I had been scheduled to do this presentation back in October, and since it was going to be before the election, I had picked out this poem, and it's about, it's on women's rights, and so I'm just going to read it to you anyway, even though the election passed. It's called Farmer Jones on Women's Rights. Farmer Jones rode into town to carry a load of produce down, to leave at a humble village store which he had supplied 20 years or more. He hitched his team and began to mutter as he took out his baskets of eggs and butter. I hope Betsy wrote them errands down. I'll always forget them when I go to town. Well, Farmer Jones, was the grocer's salute as he whetted his knife on the sole of his boot. Have you heard the news? How are you today? And what is the best-selling price for hay? One question to once, the farmer said as he took his bandana and mopped his head. I haven't heard no news. I'm pretty well. But the best price for hay is hard to tell. But I have brought some butter and garden sap and some Plymouth Rock eggs that I guess will pass. And Betsy wants a new pair of shoes. But neighbor, tell me, what's the news? Then you haven't heard the news, said Grocer Brown. There's a woman's rider a-coming to town. A woman who wants to vote and preach and whose whole life depends on making a speech. Who goes around here with her skirts a-twisting when she should be at home at work in the kitchen. Petticoat government looks like it now, thundered the grocer with darkening brow. Tis a notion that's going from town to town, and we men must rise up and put it down. To be sure, said the farmer, before it does harm. Like not, Betsy will want to rule the farm. By this time, Farmer Jones' trade was completed. And so, with his bundles and bills all receipted, he spoke to the mare, bid her to come, picked up the reins, and went jogging home. At the door, Betsy met him and asked for her shoes. But Jones' mind was overflowed with news. He passed out the bundles, and scarcely he spoke, although 'twas his habit to laugh and to joke. And not until Betsy, the table had spread, and taken her place in her seat at the head, did he give full vent to his great irritation, and gave his mixed thoughts a free circulation. Well, Betsy, he said as he sat down, I heard some strange news today in town. It fairly makes my blood run cold to think that the women are getting so bold. There's a woman's rider a-coming here, and Betsy, there's one point I want to make clear. You see, she's trying to be a man and wants to get all the women she can to follow suit and go to the polls, and they'll just get their names up and ruin their souls. And Betsy, if I catch you going to vote, I'll just hand over my pants and my coat. I'll send to the barn and hitch up old Bess and send and buy me a new calico dress. Political science must have a boost before the women can rule the roost. Her ideas are worse than those Western cyclones, and I won't have it here as sure as my name is Jones. Well, Moses, said Betsy, perfectly calm, and going to hear her, I don't see no harm. Perhaps she don't want to be a man, only wants to get what rights she can. If we went to town meeting and voted there, we'd see that the votes were counted fair. I feel interest in this new reform, and I'm going to hear her, shine or storm. Then Farmer Jones, he raved about, and threatened before she would go out, he'd shut her up in the chicken coop. But Betsy, she never budged a loop. Now 40 years with him had proved all roses, and Betsy thought by this time she could manage Moses. So to the Women's Rights Convention, Betsy went. And this I'll mention, Farmer Joe said when Grocer Brown asked him why he let her. While Betsy was just so soft, I thought I'd better. That's it.
just so what?
She was just so sot set that, yeah, that he called it sot.
Were you born at Honest John's?
I was born in Brevard Hospital.
On US 1?
On US 1. My brother and I were, my mother was not quite as old-fashioned, and she preferred to be in a hospital. My father was actually born in the house, but I was born in town. Yes?
There's a grocery store in Grant. Would that have been your father's store, that old two-story?
It wasn't that particular store. Granddaddy's store was on the side street, on the south side there, and it later burned. So the one that's there now is not the original one that my grandfather had. Although I remember going down there as a child and getting the mail. They had the post office in the back of the store, and they had the post office box and everything back there. They've made that store into a business called Rib City now, that's located there.
So you took the boat across the store?
Yes, we always took the boat over to Grandma's, and Grandma had what we called a wash shed. It had a washing machine inside the shed, it had a shower, and then it had places where you could fold the clothes. And then outside, there was a concrete, a brick and concrete...
wash pot.
Yeah, it was a wash pot, but it was made of concrete, and you boiled the water. You put the wood underneath it and boiled, set it a fire and boiled the water, and then you took the water and put it into the washing machine for your hot water. And then they had clotheslines.
Is that one of those little wringer washers?
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, so if you put your hand in there, you're...
Oh, yeah.
So we were always,
flat.
I know. Yes.
Was that part, is that part of your home? Or did they kind of overlap with
them? No, the Indian River Lagoon Preserve State Park, at one point in time, many...
Not the park, the, what is
that?
Community center?
Oh, the community center.
The community.
No, actually, Granddaddy owned... some of the land east of where we are today, but back then, they would swap land for a mule or horse or, seeds or something like that, and so he swapped some of the land. And then when my grandfather died, he left the land that was on the barrier island, which was the peninsula, to the sons, and the land that was in Grant was given to the girls. So my two uncles sold their share, and they eventually was bought by St. John's River Water Management District. So, but we own the main portion that was still the homestead. Beth?
What year did your mother stop driving the school bus?
Well, she started, I guess you could officially say she started in 1949, and she drove for 16 years.
Yep.
Yes. I see you.
A number of years ago, you all had a festival out there at the homestead.
Yes.
And you ever do that again?
I don't know. Maybe we get a lot of volunteers. It's a lot of work.
That was a wonderful day.
Well, thank you very much. We did open up the house and toured the house, and it was a fun thing. But it was a lot of work, and it took a lot of people, and we didn't even have enough parking space. We ran out of food. I mean, we were overwhelmed. We thought we'd have like about 300 people, and I think we had over 1,000. So it was really, really a popular place. So, yes.
Your sons still live there.
Yes, two of my sons live there.
They're so, their hospitality from there. They're always so gracious and stuff, so thank you. You raised them right. You've mentioned several times that when you go down to the Sebastian Inlet, it's like the road stops. So did you get to Vero Beach, or how did that all happen?
No, you had to go back to Melbourne and cross the bridge and go down US 1 in order to go down.
So was the inlet natural, or I thought somebody died?
No, it was dug.
Okay.
And then during the war, it was closed. There's a picture here. This is the picture. You can come up here afterwards and look at the different pictures. This is a picture about 1947 where they were blasting open the inlet because they had closed it during the war to prevent U-boats from going into the Indian River Lagoon. And so this, and you'll see what the shoreline looks like. This is the old road to the inlet is east of what present-day modern A1A is. And there's still remnants down there. If you go in the north side of the inlet, you can still see part of that old road that was there, the original road. Jim?
I was just going to say, I rode Barbara's mom's school bus when we moved out of here. And she, if you acted up on the bus, she told you one time to simmer down, and if not, she stopped the bus and kicked you out wherever you were. And you learned not to do that again.
Either that, or if it wasn't too bad a misbehavior, she would make you sit up in the hot seat,
right,
which was the top step of the floor as you got into the bus, and that was where the engine was, and it was hot there from the I've been on the bus and she would stop and blow her whistle and the bus would really get quiet.
Jim, that's why I asked that question, because Cottie would tell me how if you misbehaved on that bus, you would walk
home. And she would take the football teams down south and everything, because they knew that they weren't going to act up.
She did. She drove all the athletics out of the high school, baseball, football, and the cheerleaders were, and I got to go with her, of course, wherever she went, and the cheerleaders were always jealous of me because I got to be on the bus with the football players. You know? But little did they know they were smelly after the game. Nobody really wanted to be on the bus with them. I didn't tell the cheerleaders that. Right in the back.
Yes, Barbara, how big was your biggest trout?
12 pounds, 2 ounces. Still a record.
Yeah. She's quite the fishing lady.
That's my other hat. Yes.
I kind of like to hear the story of how your dad got the name of Honest John.
Well, there's more than one story on that. He had a cousin named John Bolton, and they were about the same age, and people, they hung out together, and people would always get them confused, and they'd say, which John, to my father, which John are you? And he said, I'm the Honest John. So that was one of the stories of how he got his name. Yes?
Do you remember seeing any of those animals when you were a child?
I remember the panthers. We still have lots of bobcats. Bears. Granddaddy dug an area out in the woods where the bears would come from the mainland, and they'd swim across the river, and then they would go to the beach in the summertime and they'd eat the turtle eggs. And so Granddaddy dug out a shallow area in the woods, kind of like a circle, and when the rain would come, it would fill that area up with rainwater. And when the bears came to the beach, they would have that rainwater to drink because they couldn't drink the salt water from the ocean. So as a child, we called it, was the bear well, is what we called it. Yes?
Do you still live on the property?
I do.
Okay.
I built a dome home on the property, which is hurricane-proof and tornado-proof and fire-proof. And my son thought I should build a cracker house, but... I said, well, now we have something old and now we have something new.
Do you stay there during the hurricanes? Is that what you're saying?
I was going to stay there. That was one of the reasons, you know, because all my windows and doors are rated for 160 mile an hour winds. And my boss, unfortunately, wanted me to go with him just after the hurricane. And so I was afraid I couldn't get across the bridge because they closed the bridges. And so I actually went into West Melbourne and stayed with my youngest son. But that was my plan, was to stay there. But my son Jonathan stayed there, and he stayed in the house, and he said, he went to sleep, and he said, I didn't even hear anything. So, yeah. But my father never left in any hurricane, and I thought as he got older, it was going to be a problem trying to get him to leave, but fortunately I didn't have to do that. But he would send my brother and my mother and myself to town, during a hurricane. And actually, one time when we had like hurricane force winds, you didn't know back then when a hurricane was coming, but Dad had a barometer, and he could tell by the barometer. And Mom was driving the school bus home, and the wind was so strong it was blowing the doors of the school bus in, so she had the biggest boy on the bus to stand down there to keep the doors from coming in. She also, the Stone children, like I said, was they were sort of a poor family. And so when all the kids from Melbourne Beach would get off the bus, and only just a few kids from the South Melbourne Beach were on there, we would stop, and there's a stretch there south of what's now Driftwood Plaza. And we'd all get off the bus and run through the palmettos, and they would catch the armadillos. And then they would take them over to Hopkins, and they would sell them over there because they really didn't have a lot of money. But even though she was strict, she was also good too. Anything else?
Oh, yes. Did your mom get paid?
She did get paid, yes.
By who?
By the county. Oh. Yeah. She worked as a bus driver for Brevard Public Schools. Okay. Yes?
Can you just read the last line of the poem, because I lost it. I was so focused on Bessie and her husband that I didn't hear the last line of your poem that you read.
Oh,
it's not her.
Sure.
She said, "I'm going," and he said,
So to the Women's Rights Convention Betsy went, and this I'll mention. Jones said when Grocer Brown asked him why he let her, "While Betsy was just so soft, I thought I'd better." My grandmother was really the one that liked to do a lot of poems, and one of her daughters for Christmas one year typed up all the poems that she loved to give, to recite, and gave them to members of the family. So we have all those really neat poems, and I can remember her reciting them. So is there, you know, you had to have something to do. We didn't have TV back then.
When were you electrified? Do you remember what year?
We had what I remember. Let's see. We had kerosene lamps, and so basically you went to bed with the chickens because you didn't have a lot of light. Then we got what we called a light plant, which was a generator, which was noisy, and we put on the back of the barn or the net house, which is later known as the net house. So we thought we were really in the uptown status at that point. I think we got electricity probably in the mid-50s. It was a while. We had party line phones.
Yeah.
399-M4 was our number. And you'd pick up the phone and somebody was always on it. Yes.
What major changes have you seen to the topography and the, like, it used to be tons of oysters here and stuff like that. What have you seen over the years change drastically?
I've seen the Indian River Lagoon change drastically. There are no sawfish left in the lagoon anymore. Oysters are pretty much gone. Saltwater intrusion, oyster borers, some of those things have come in. Detrimental impacts to the lagoon, such as runoff, septic tanks, things like that. Recent oil from the roadways going into the lagoon. Now the county does make you, if you're building on the lagoon, to have swales and things to try to contain some of that water for a period of time. They have baffle boxes that they put in to try to catch those sediments before they go out into the lagoon. I can remember even 30 years ago seeing mullet just so thick you could go out and walk on. You can't see that anymore. Redfish, you catch one right after the other.
The phosphorescence.
Yes, and we would go to my grandmother's in Grant by boat, and then of course she always made chicken and rice for Sunday dinner. You know, we take the laundry over the wash over there and come back. And at night we would put our hands and arms over the side of the boat, and you would see the phosphorus in the river, and it was really, really pretty. You did see that here not too long ago. This fall, there was a period of time there when you could see the phosphorus again, but it's not on a nightly occurrence like it used to be. Yes?
Did your father ever hire out as a fish guy, a fishing guy?
Dad really didn't do that. He became an iron worker, and he tied steel and worked on the Melbourne airport and worked down in Palm Beach County. It was not a guide thing for him. He just enjoyed it. And I will say, I have to admit, that he holds the trout record for the fish camp. And he never let me forget it either. Anyway, you're welcome to come up and look at some of the pictures. One of the pictures here is a picture that my Aunt Ida painted of my grandfather. And there's some other pictures here. If I can answer any questions, I'll be happy to do so. Ron?